Okay. So, welcome, Mrs. Hadid. It's a real great pleasure for us to see you here in the Heydar Aliyev Center. So, we would like to ask you a few questions so you can share your impressions with us. You attended the groundbreaking ceremony of the Heydar Aliyev Center, and now you're here today after some time and the center is fully functional. So, can you tell us what are your impressions of the final appearance of the project?
Well, I think it's, you know, amazing because, you know, when you design a project, you have certain expectations, and you know, it's not always, you don't end up with what you want. And I think it's been a really an incredible experiment for us in terms of achieving this building, which is quite, you know, complex and quite difficult, and achieving it in this way, I think it's been fantastic.
So, just coming to the sort of the whole concept of the Heydar Aliyev Center, I mean, definitely it's a magnificent building, but can you share with us maybe a very short story? How did the whole idea emerge with you?
Well, I think that in about, let's say 20 years ago, we were trying to, you know, doing research, design research, to discover what is the best way to achieve a certain scale of buildings. And at the time, we thought of the idea of land formation, and then it became land formation, topography and landscape. And I think this project was one of the outcome of these 20 years of experimentation in this topography and landscape research. But of course, aided with the computational skills, one was able to achieve what we call complete fluid architecture. So the idea for fluidity in this building was to how the park on the exterior, how the city merges with the interior in a seamless, continuous way. And that the like the tiling of this building with the tiling of the floor is almost the same material. So as you move around the building, the idea that there were three programs and each program is merged with the next program. So they are seen as one building with three entities. Let's say it could be a cultural facility, a museum, a theater, and the library. All they flew onto each other in a seamless way. So instead of having three different blocks, the blocks are one like a mountain range or, you know, whatever.
So looking at the works that you've created for many years, one can see there are some pieces of architecture where you have sharp angles, some which are more of a curved lines.
I mean, I think the original work was all to do with, let's say, sharp angles, not because of the angle, because it was at the time, you know, like shards or breaking of glass and whatever. But I think it eventually merged into fluidity. So in a way, let's say if you imagine bits of ice breaking in the water and icebergs, and we maybe had the more sharpness, but ultimately we wanted to achieve total fluidity, and that change from the break to a to one continuous object.
So, in addition to become known as the venue of international conferences, Heydar Aliyev Center also initiated a number of projects, and I think you've been to some of these, or at least you've seen some of these in the center. What's your impression of the projects that you see here? The exhibits.
Well, I think it's very interesting because, you know, obviously some of them are very nice, some of them are so-so, but I think what is interesting from people from art to see the level of investment in new architecture in the city. You know, I was really amazed when I returned how much has changed. You know, it has a much more urban feeling. Everything is very manicured and lit up. It feels more dense. So I think that, you know, I think in the 4 or 5 years it also changed a lot. And I think it's nice for people to see what kind of things are going on here, what people are designing or what they're doing.
How did Soviet and historical background of Baku affect the initial concept?
Well, I mean, I think that, I mean, the issue with context is more to do with the maybe social context or other forces which can operate on a project as opposed to just your immediate context. we know that this program is different than the block. They're not the same as the blocks, because the blocks are all housing or offices or whatever. So this was really, this work is about anti-block architecture. So it relates in terms of more program. You know, there's a cultural program relating to the neighboring buildings as opposed to imitating the existing things.
Avant-garde architecture encouraged the development of digital technologies. And what would you create without, in pre-computer generated architecture, before the computer?
Well, I think that the ideas of this product really was generated before computational skills. But I think what computational skills have done for this project in particular was interesting, because I think that one could have never achieved this level of fluidity. And also, what is interesting about computation is that it makes it seamless, not only in the architecture, but in the way you produce material, you know, in production and in fabrication. So I think it is very exciting the way all the exterior was fabricated all through computing, you know, all the skin, to achieve this level of precision. I think it could have been done before, but I think it would not with the same level of precision. And also consistency. So I think one has been able through computation to achieve things which are maybe difficult to achieve before.
What's your attitude towards paper architects, I think? Those who are more theoreticians.
Well, happened to be a very close friend of mine. I mean, he passed away a year ago, but he was a very close friend. And I personally believe that the message from any project in architecture is equally important. But what I think is very great about experiencing a building and space, you know, I think in drawing you can only imagine, and when you build it you can actually experience it. And I think that the paper projects were very important to do the next iteration, to make the next experiment.
How do you find the balance between functionality and beautiful concept?
I think you can do them more. As long as you can, I mean, the issue is you have to challenge the orthodox way of, of dealing with space. I think that, for example, in certain places, they think that the only optimal space is done in a very particular way. And I obviously don't believe that. You know, I think that you can achieve a different kind of function or the same function through a different speciality. If you look at the idea of the theater, historically, it was never always done the same way, or a living room or a bedroom or an office space. They don't have to, I mean, certain programs, of course, they have to adhere the size of a stadium or a swimming pool or theater have certain kind of parameters. Which are there optimized, but the way they look don't have to be all the same.
What is your attitude towards preserving the historical buildings?
I think it is very important to keep some of them if they have very high value, if they are very good. But I think it's equally important to be able to do new things, because that also is symbolic of that generation, of that moment. I don't think everything old is good and everything is new is bad. I think you have to be able to marry these worlds.
So Mrs. Hadid, everything changes, architecture changes too. So what is your view on how the architecture will look like, say, in 25 years from now?
I don't know, I couldn't say. I mean, I think that, 30 years ago, people did not expect there would be such a radical change in that period. And there was, you know? And that was, I think, is very exciting, that in my one's lifetime, witness this change. In the same way, one witnessed the change in modernism, you know, from very kind of traditional buildings to modernism. That must have been a very exciting moment. And it happened again in the 60s. So I think that, you know, I don't know, I think it depends. I think that not all the ideas have yet to be achieved. When I started work, I thought the modernist project was not completed, and therefore this is a continuation of modernism. But as I researched, we discovered something else, which is not just the early modernist period. So I think that some of these issues which we are discussing now, or we are doing now, then we get more refined and more elaborated in future.
what project would you like to realize in Iraq?
Well, I think that, you know, in Iraq, you know, we're doing the central bank. We might be doing some other projects. I mean, I have a particular interest in Iraq in planning, for example, because that will set the roots for a new life. It doesn't have to be grand building. It could be, you know, just very simple ideas of how you develop your cities for the future, because, you know, in Iraq, nothing happened for 30 years. And so I think this could be very interesting to be involved in the way the seeds are planted in these places.
And what was your first architectural impressions of Baku?
I actually like it. Also, you know, it's very nice light, the light. And I think people who have this nice light, like the Mediterranean, people expect it to happen everywhere. It doesn't happen everywhere. And that impacts on the way you see the buildings as well, because sometimes they are, because it's quite flat, so it lit it very differently. I think also the different periods of architecture in Baku, they work very well together, you know, whether pre-Soviet, post-Soviet, during Soviet, you know, and I have a particular interest in constructivism, especially in my early period. So I think it's very nice to, it has a kind of familiarity to me, Baku, although I don't know it very well, because it has this marriage of maybe some of kind of West ideas merged with maybe traditional Eastern ideas. Like if you go to the bazaar or the old town, you have these worlds all exist at the same time.
Okay, thank you very much indeed for taking time. Thank you.